Chapter 19, Spiritual Healing. This is the highest form of healing, and is much rarer and less common than is generally believed to be the case. Many healers doing very good work along the lines of mental healing, believe, and teach, that their work is done along spiritual lines. But in this they are mistaken. True spiritual healing is not done by anyone. In such cases the healer becomes an instrument or channel through which flows the spiritual healing force of the universe. That is, the healer is able to open up his spiritual mind as a channel for the inflow of the spiritual force of the universe, which passes through the healer into the spiritual mind of the patient, and there sets up vibrations of such intensity and strength that it invigorates the lower mental principles, and finally the organs and parts themselves, restoring them to normal condition. Spiritual cures are often practically instantaneous, although it does not necessarily follow that they must always be so. The spiritual healer allowing the spiritual healing force to flow through him to the patient, causes the latter to be literally bathed in a flow of spirit, as we have heard it expressed. In order to understand this form of treatment intelligently, the reader must acquaint himself with the yogi teachings regarding the several mental principles, which teaching he will find in the 14 Lessons in Yogi Philosophy, published by the same publishers as this book. We do not care to repeat here what we have said on this subject, although it may be well to say a few words regarding the spiritual mind, that this form of treatment may be better understood. The spiritual mind of man is that principle of mind that is above and higher than the two lower mental principles known as instinctive mind and intellect, respectively. Spiritual mind is above the plane of intellect, just as the instinctive mind is below the plane of intellect. The spiritual mind has not as yet developed or unfolded into consciousness in the average man, although some of the more advanced of the race, those who have gone ahead of their brothers on the path, have unfolded the spiritual mind into consciousness, or, rather, have moved the center of consciousness into the region of the spiritual mind. This higher mental principle is what we try to express when we say the something within that seems to exert a protecting influence over us, and which sends us words of caution or advice in moments of need. All that the race has received in the way of noble, elevating, higher thoughts have come from this region of the mind. The spiritual mind projects fragments of truth into the lower mental principles. All that has come to the race, in its evolution, that has tended toward nobility, true religious feeling, kindness, humanity, justice, unselfish love, mercy, sympathy, etc., has come to it through the slowly unfolding spiritual mind. As the unfoldment goes on, man's idea of justice increases, and he has more compassion. His feeling of human brotherhood increases, his idea of love grows, and he increases in all the qualities which men of all creeds pronounce good. The spiritual mind is the source of the inspiration which certain poets, painters, sculptors, writers, preachers, orators, and others have received in all times, and which they receive today. This is the source from which the seer obtains his vision, the prophet his foresight. Many have concentrated themselves upon high ideals in their work, and have received rare knowledge from this source, which they have attributed to beings from another world, from angels, from spirits, from God himself, but all came from within. It was their higher self speaking to them. This does not mean that man never receives communications from the other sources just named, far from this, for we know that the latter is often evidenced and experienced. But we do mean that man receives far more messages from the higher self than he does from the other sources, and that man is prone to mistake the one for the other. We cannot discuss this matter at length, in this place, for it is foreign to the subject which we are handling at the present time. Man, by the development of his spiritual consciousness, may bring himself into a higher relationship and contact with this higher part of his nature, and may thus become possessed of knowledge beyond the power of the intellect to furnish. Certain high powers are also open to a man in this way, but he must beware against using them for any purpose other than the good of his fellow men, for such prostitution of spiritual powers brings a terrible result in its train. Such is the law. And, while it is true that the fullest degree of spiritual healing is not open to the average person, still it is likewise true that the healer who is possessed of a degree of spiritual unfoldment may avail himself of a certain degree of spiritual power in treating his fellow men. In fact, the best healers, consciously or unconsciously, Make use of this force in this way, and they are right in so doing. It is a proper use of the power. Spiritual healing may be used in connection with the other forms of healing described and explained in this book, to good advantage, and without interfering with the other treatments. In fact, all conscientious healers should endeavor to give the patients the benefit of this form of treatment in connection with the regular treatments. The spiritual law, always working for good, cannot be misapplied or prostituted in cases of relief to suffering humanity, so the healer need never fear that in so acting he is dragging down the spiritual to the material level. For the spiritual permeates everything, and if it may be used to bring up those on a lower plane, it is well used. In the next chapter we shall endeavor to give the student a few explanations and some information regarding the practice of spiritual healing, although, as will readily be seen, it is almost impossible to tell one how to do something that consists in letting rather than doing. And we must ask the student to approach this part of the subject with a feeling of sufficient respect, for in spiritual healing, one is calling into operation forces and power of an entirely different order from those with which man is acquainted in this everyday life. The spiritual healer is allowing himself to be used as a channel for the transmission of that force from the great ocean of spirit to the spiritual mind of the patient, and he should endeavor to make himself a worthy instrument of that power and spirit.